Welcome back. In this video, I will try to break down the key parts of how I made my latest short clip in Godot. The inspiration of my forest at night scene was something as mundane as a forum post reminding me I had made a forest clip before. This was arguably my first attempt at making something look good in 3D, and while I remember being happy with it at the time, it's definitely deserving of an overhaul. Before I get into any details, I've had several people commenting on the clip that it's too dark. While I understand the complaint, there isn't a huge amount I can do about it, as each monitor or TV is calibrated differently and there is no way to suit all viewers. I've shown this difference here as best I can, where I've recorded my monitor and my TV using my camera. In many games, especially dark horror type games, you'd be provided a calibration setting in the menu. However, this obviously isn't possible for YouTube videos. On the monitor I do all my work on, I can faintly see the checkered box in the bottom right corner. However, my TV was dramatically different on all of its inbuilt profiles, with the best only able to show the top right checkered box. As is often the case, I started out in Blender, putting a camera 2 meters above a flat plane and making sure I could always see this in the viewport. This ensures I can always see from the over-the-shoulder perspective I plan to use in Godot, and I'm constantly checking this to make sure the fore, mid, and background objects have a pleasing scale relative to the size of the character. Then I just blocked out the scene with generic shapes to get a rough idea of what I felt looked good or not. This process proved pretty haphazard, with me chopping and changing stuff, but I quickly settled on the idea this would be a rather long and open shot instead of the claustrophobic forest scene I did before. Following this, I started sculpting out a better idea of how I wanted the terrain to look, scraping out a river and building a cliff face. Detail was added using stencils, but I would later bake these details out to normal maps. This is an effective way to provide detail on objects, but using lower polygon meshes, improving performance. This is something I did not know when I made my first 3D scenes, and is a big reason why the performance was so poor. This cliff started out with 10,000 vertices, but by baking the normal maps to a low polygon version, I was able to bring that count down to 1/10 of that with minimal quality loss. I also made sure to cut out any parts of the mesh that weren't likely to be seen by the viewer, but didn't spend too much time on this. I painted textures onto the terrain and cliffs and placed trees and foliage in a roughly believable way. I knew much of the foliage work I would do directly in Godot, so at this stage it was more about nailing down the concept art for the scene and getting all the assets in roughly the right place before importing them. I knew I would also add a river later, so was happy that this was good enough. After importing everything into Godot, the rest was easy. Light the sky, set fire to something, grow some grass, and sprinkle in a bit of water. Now, I've grossly oversimplified this, but ultimately each of these steps could have a video unto themselves, but I've instead opted to give some clues as to where you can find more details for each. Much of what I did was, like my last video, trial and error, and I recommend you do the same to find the look and feel that works for you. However, there is one component here I ended up following my own route. And let me caveat this front and center, this is not the best way to do this. When I went looking for realistic 3D fire in Godot, I was mostly met by more stylized tutorials that weren't really suited to my scene. Instead, I looked up how to simulate fire in Blender, and really just followed a tutorial verbatim, deciding that would be good enough. Once I had baked out the fire simulation, I imported it into Godot as an animated 3D sprite. You just need to create a new frame resource, then navigate to our folder of rendered images and select them all, remembering to set the frame rate speed. Hit play and, well, not quite what I was after. To get around this, I thought, all you really need is more angles. So I went back into Blender and created 16 cameras arranged around the fire. Blender has this neat stereoscopic feature I didn't know about that allows you to simultaneously render to multiple cameras, I think intended for viewing things in 3D. So I took that and rendered the simulation to all 16 cameras, with each named according to their cardinal direction. This produced this wonderful folder full of... Well, I warned you this wasn't a great way to do it. Once I'd created all 16 sprites in Godot, it created this pretty effect, but that's still not what I was after, so the last piece of the puzzle would be done in code. Firstly, I'll need to modulate the light energy to give a flickering effect. So I set up a few variables on the OmniLight base node to track this. Then I added an array of suffixes for all of the cardinal directions to be used later. Then I'll need a function that maps the angle observed to the cardinal directions I've declared above. As this is running in a tool script for testing, I use setget functions to effectively give me a button in the inspector to apply an update to any values. I tend to use my own template for scripts, so I'll remove the parts I don't need to make it easier to read. Here I'm just applying the moderation to light energy within the physics process, which runs continuously to give the flickering effect. Now, you should recall we currently have a flat plane showing our fire animation and the player's camera facing it. The original approach I considered fired a ray cast to the plane to discern the angle of impact, ensuring as the player moved, I could constantly track how the angle changed. This could then be repeated for all the remaining flat planes. However, it dawned on me this was essentially overkill and more complex than it needed to be. Godot's 2D vector class already has an angle to point function, and as the fire would only be viewed horizontally, the camera's and the fire's position could also be considered flat. So it just becomes a matter of taking the camera's and the fire's X and Z positions and passing this to the angle to point function to get the degrees. Now every frame I perform just one check to confirm the angle from the player to the fire instead of 16 ray casts to each plane. This check is happening every frame, so firstly I hide all of the animated sprites. Then I use our cardinal direction function from before, which now reshows the sprite that faces the camera and the two closest directions facing the camera. This allows for the next block of code, which attempts to moderate the opacity of each sprite based on the view angle, in effect blurring them into each other as the camera pans. While this is far from perfect, it gave the effect I was after, though it did take a fair amount of trial and error to get it there. Also, an eagle-eyed viewer may notice the seriously obvious repetition in the animated sprite loop and my far from optimized code. Luckily, the overheads for this seem to be tiny. For the smoke, I used mostly transparent animated particles, as shown in some other tutorials. Then a separate particle setup was used for the embers, using a different sprite and applying various randomizations to its movement. I also enabled emission to ensure that they glowed and applied a fall-off to their opacity so they faded out during their lifetime. Finally, for the heat haze, I nipped onto the Godot Shaders website and found what I was looking for easily enough, tweaking it a bit to suit and applying to some particle spheres that were large enough to encompass the fire, giving a wobbly haze effect. After the fireflies were just green spheres with emission cranked up, and I felt like the scene was looking good, but something was still missing. Something big. Originally, this guy was supposed to be a giant moth. Then I remembered, I'm not all that great at sculpting, and modeling animals is really hard, so I settled on some kind of huge golem. My early approach was pretty terrible, but then I remembered I already had a rock generator of sorts that would allow me to stick to a really rough shape, but have the detail added for me. Again, similar approaches already have tutorials online, so I won't repeat anything here. Even I knew this was a night scene and he would be in the background, I wasn't overly worried, as long as the overall shape was right. I then applied a very basic bone rig for animation and spent an irritatingly long amount of time weight painting. This is the process of defining what parts of the mesh are affected by each of the bones, and is possibly the aspect of Blender I find most likely to misbehave. After this, I took a look at cell fracturing in Blender, which lets you break meshes up into chunks, which is really useful for destruction. Then using physics to animate the mountain being destroyed. Godot's physics probably could have handled this, but pre-baking the animation should keep the overheads far lower. Irritatingly, this meant each of the chunks of terrain effectively had its own animation track, but was easily fixed once imported by writing my own play and stop function that iterates the list of animations. Then I added more particle effects like the explosion and heat haze for the eyes and linked their motion together with the animation. Finally tying it all off with a bit of camera shake and screen blur. As what I thought would be a final flourish, I downloaded a Mixmo character, which is a great free resource of pre-animated 3D models, or you can upload your own and apply animations to it. The idea was I would smash out a simple third-person controller and perhaps turn this scene into a small playable arena and let people download it. This proved to be more hassle than it was worth, and I quickly lost interest in the idea, but kept the character in there regardless. And with that, I decided the scene was done. I think I'll cut it there for now, as this format takes an inordinately long amount of time to make, even when I'm just rushing through one or two key points. I really appreciate any feedback in the comments on what you liked or want to see more of, and hope you enjoyed it. Thanks.